Oh, hi. Didn't see you there. Enjoying this wonderful pizza from Slice on Broadway, the people in Pittsburgh that provide good pizza, the podcasters. Hey guys, it's Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter. It's the Awesomecast number 250, hitting a little bit of a milestone there, creeping up on our five-year anniversary. Wow. Thank you, Uncle Crappy, for pointing that out, by the way. He's on with us, Uncle Crappy from the Uncle Crappy Command Center in Bellevue, PA.
At the Crap Center.
Yeah, the Crap Center. Or Crappy House. Whichever. I noticed round numbers like that. So 250, I'm like, really? 250? Mm-hmm. That's a pretty cool thing. So congratulations on that.
Awesome. Awesome. And, you know, we can call it Studio C for you. Or do we give that to somebody
that's cool.
else?
That's fine.
Also, on the couch, we're doubled up again. We got Dutters back in the studio, of course.
Looking at us.
That's us.
Oh, don't I didn't turn the TV on in front of you?
No.
Oh, jeez. Well, there you go. Well, we'll leave it on
you. Are you listening?
At KDutters on the Twitters as I'm turning the TV on so they can see other people. Excuse me. That was close.
Now we get to see ourselves.
There you go.
The magic of the TVs.
Yeah. Studio monitors come in handy. At KDutters, at Chilla on the Twitters. How you guys doing?
Oh, good. I'm glad my shirt shows up really well. It says, I run for whiskey.
There you go. And, of course, you can join us here in this craziness live every Tuesday about 7, maybe a little earlier very soon, at live.awesomecast.net. You can probably hang out about 6:30 or so in the chat room. Wheels is in there hanging out. He was sad because we kind of moved the show. And we didn't tell him, so sorry about that, but he had his pizza. Anyways, but you can check out everything else going on, awesomecast.net. We've been doing some mini awesome casts, some news bites. We're going to switch around the schedule a little bit for that as well, but those will be popping up here later this week. And, of course, awesome chat. We talked with our friend Chris Aiken from the Coin Op Hall of Fame, and I want to talk about that a little bit later in the show, but please check that out. And we got another one lining up within our Alpha Lab alumni with Nebulous. So editing audio in the cloud. We talked about them briefly on the show when I first discovered these guys, and they've come so far since then. So let's get into... Oh, and also, please subscribe to us. We're on YouTube, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and please check us out on the social medias at AwesomeCast. AwesomeCast on the Facebook groups, and Google+. So let's get into the awesome things of the week. You guys all got them lined up here, so let's knock them down. Let's start with you. Let's start with the returning Uncle Crappy.
Hello. Guys, if you've been watching this for a while, you know that I'm employed as a member of the mainstream media, and I'm always happy to see instances where my old-fashioned side of my profession collides with the more modern side. I came across a thing on Politico today, actually, about Snapchat hiring to get people ready to cover the presidential campaign in 2016, which is well underway right now. And this is a cool thing. Being people in my profession are just kind of figuring out what Snapchat is. I know a colleague of mine had a week-long Kiplinger fellowship at The Ohio State University. It's just completely coincidence that I'm wearing this and mentioning this. And one of the platforms that they covered, this is a comprehensive social media thing for old media folks like me. But one of the things that they covered fairly extensively was Snapchat. Snapchat has added a dozen or so dedicated channels for mainstream media outlets. And some of them are doing some really cool stuff. I don't know if the Washington Post is one of the channels that Snapchat has let onto the platform, but they do really, really cool stuff. That's something that you can subscribe to, just as a daily feature mm-hmm. that they add to as they go through the day. It's something that I don't know really well. I will admit that, but I've played around with it a little bit. But it's interesting to me to see what. Yeah, there's a quick look at. Mm-hmm. You can see some of the outlets here. You can see CNN and some and the Food Network.
Daily Mail is a part of this.
But this is something that the folks in my business are just starting to pay attention to. I'm curious what you guys would think as someone sort of on the other side of this equation. If that's something that that you would watch, that you would follow, whether it's presidential campaign or just kind of more mainstream news in general, is this a viable thing? Is that Snapchat is a good place for this to be?
Is it? When I think Snapchat, I automatically think of a younger audience than us. Is that mm-hmm. bad?
Mm-hmm. That's kind of when I was doing my talk last week over at Carnegie Library, it was like, this is Snapchat. You in this room are not going to understand why this is a popular thing, but you want the people who are, probably, right? So, yeah, exactly. But
so, I mean, it's another outlet. It's another way to connect with them and on their own terms, in own turf, essentially. And you can target all the stuff towards them and what maybe they're more interested. I mean, I might not be interested in a particular topic that somebody, you know, in their 60s, 70, you know, whatever, who's not using this particular medium might be, you know, it's, you know, more into one thing and they're more into another thing. So then you can kind of target your message too. And maybe something, they might cover more of something versus something else.
I think it gives them the ability to split demographics, to your point. Mm-hmm. Bringing in that younger audience, and I'm not familiar with voting demographics, but I'm guessing the younger audience is the lesser of the likely to go out and vote and to get involved and engaged. And to me,
that is correct.
This is this is definitely a way to get them engaged. Yes. As far as a model for news delivery for me, if there was more technology news, I would probably get into that, and then it would probably lead me down the path of, oh, I'm out of tech news to read. I'll go check out CNN or I'll go check out this or that. I'd be interested to see what the intersection of like Flipboard users are versus Snapchat versus whatever. So for me, I would rather use something like Flipboard because it seems to aggregate other media networks as well, which is why I like Flipboard.
That makes sense to me. Just in terms of demographics, I know, you know, John, you're of the age. The thing that I read as I was looking into Snapchat and after finding the story today was something like, if you were born before 1985, you will not understand Snapchat at all.
No, no.
What did you read?
I graduated from high school in 1985, so I'm well within that category. And I love Flipboard and I love what it does as an aggregator and just how stuff is presented. I still think it's one of the most elegant things I've ever come across on the internet. I think Flipboard is something where that can reach a sort of a wider demographic. You know, which is maybe why, John, you know, someone like you is a little bit younger than I am. You're going to look at that and you're going to look at Flipboard, and but you may have a greater comfort with Snapchat than most of the folks who would be my age or older.
Yeah. And that's one of the interesting things is there was that the Oregon Trail post that you were referring to that you read? Because that was actually a really good post. Carla actually pointed out to me about there's like an in-between age group of like the people that were born in the late 70s and up through like 82, right, where it's this weird intersected demographic of, I can still remember 8-tracks. I can still remember records and tape cassettes and all of those things. And I'm right at that brink of, you know, you came home from school and you jumped on AOL, but that was more towards the end of middle school and through some of high school. So I can remember a time when the personal computer wasn't in everybody's house, but a lot of people had them. Mm-hmm. And then into college when just right before Facebook and MySpace was big, Facebook hadn't really launched, made out past a couple campuses, things of that nature. So I feel like I am in that in-between generation of... I like this, but I can also understand both sides of what's going on as far as Snapchat versus Flipboard versus let's go old school and let's just grab RSS feeds from everything, because that's another way to do it for the more technical people.
Right. And I still do.
Well, and that's where I look at that. It's going to be interesting because I think there's going to there's going to be a segregation point where people... you're going to have like the ultra techies and you're going to have the people that don't care to figure out how things work or what to do or whatever, and they're going to be your Snapchat user, but you're still going to have those people that still go into IRC chat. And I remember going on to AOL back in the day and like old school news groups and things of that nature that still exist and are still very popular. But I just do not, I see them being for the more technical. I'm kind of digressing from your point, but yeah, I totally agree that you're going to have to start targeting demographics purely based on what social media network you're on. And you're going to have to probably sooner or later be on all of them.
Mm-hmm. Especially for a big brand like that. Mm-hmm. You just want that penetration everywhere. Whereas, I'm talking with smaller people. It's like, no, you got to pick one and do it good before you move on. And is there crosstalk, Pinterest to your Facebook and everything like that. And my big thing with this is it's very limited. Again, part of that conversation was like, pay attention to this. There's the Discover tab. There's a lot happening here. You're getting your Yahoo and Katie Couric's on there, and there is news here, and it's really intriguing, and it's reaching out to that audience that's there in Snapchat, but you don't have access to it yet, right? Maybe, mm-hmm. Maybe the news, maybe the Post-Gazette will at some point, but can me as, whereas I can go on something like Clamor that we've been talking about here and be a media presence as Sorgatron Media. I can't go on Snapchat, be Sorgatron Media, and have that same level of presence as these guys. But then again, there's that argument of the parity and like YouTube. I'm as equal on YouTube as far as content as any of these properties, right?
Right.
So maybe they're just kind of making a little bit of a gatekeeper there to take advantage of that, because probably they're the ones that are going to pay money, right?
Do they have the ability? The thing
is, you guys just said about tailoring content, maybe even down to specific platforms. I think that's a really, really good point. What the Washington Post does, and I haven't checked out all the different channels that are available now, but in watching what the Washington Post does, a big reason why it is so well done is because it is edited. It is someone who is familiar with the platform. I don't know who the folks are, but someone who's familiar with the platform takes the time and builds stuff that works for the platform. And if more outlets can do that, whether we're talking about Snapchat or other platforms, that's going to be a big help.
Certainly. All right. Let us know what you think about that. It's definitely going to be interesting to watch Snapchat as they grow here.
Are there any of the media platforms where you can easily poll without using some other polling service kind of joined into that?
Google Plus has one.
Do they have polls?
They have a pretty good poll system.
They just don't have a huge...
And of course, Facebook on groups.
Yeah, I feel like you're getting really into the smaller demographics. I'm trying to reach a wider audience, but hit those poll marks.
It's hard to be CNN, have a page, and have a poll.
Yeah.
Without something else going on, right?
Yes.
So,
yes.
Anyways, how about Dutters? What's your awesome thing of the week?
Hey, we're getting a whole bunch of new stuff to watch on Periscope.
Yes, we are.
Because it's now in the... it's all now on Android. Google Play. I think this is going to open up a lot of, a little more connection between people and more content. It'll be interesting to see who else jumps on company-wise with Periscope, because now that it's on Android. Because I actually saw another article about, kind of totally unrelated, about they're going to see in China, there's sort of been like a 20% increase over these last years of people buying new smartphones. And next year is going to be the year that it totally slows down to like 10-11% because it's oversaturated in China. And I was looking at the breakdown of who owns the market in China, and it's Android is like 70%. There's iOS is only like, gosh, it was a little less than 20. And then they showed it like in 2019 versus today, and the only one that grew was Windows Phone. So that's kind of a side note along the way. So maybe Periscope on Windows Phone is definitely going to be the next jump. But yeah, so I think it's going to be fun to see more content. We'll be able to connect with more of our friends.
It's not that limitation, because it's Wheels in the chat room has been talking about how he wants to get on something, and we had Miriscope baited about a month ago. He's been testing out with that, and he's been meerkatting us on the show through the stream with his pizza. you know, stuff like that. And I am seeing more people jump on even before this. And I'm already, I noticed a new name, one of the guys, like apparently Uncle Crappy, because I've been playing, I queued up a Periscope here as we're going. And just a little behind the scenes, you know, kind of a little bit of what's going on here, right? And just for anybody who wants to check it out, Ken in there says he's an insider now. Welcome.
Yes.
I'm getting stars and such. But no, I think, yeah, now there's not as big of a limitation on that. And yeah, just more great stuff. Like I said, I've seen some names that I know from Wrestling Mayhem Show, some of our readers or some of our listeners, awesome. You know, I mean, it is the biggest platform, you know, knowing that, you know, anybody that's on Android can hop on there.
Is there any limitation to the device type that you can install? And that's the one thing I've started to notice pop up on a couple of my different Android devices, is where it's like, this can only be installed on a phone. This can only be installed on a tablet. This can only, and it's unlike the Apple way of, you can install the phone app on a tablet, but you're going to get it either enlarged or it's going to be kind of in that 1x window mode. Versus, there's certain apps that maybe your iPad only, but they don't even show up on the phone.
We're trying it on my new.
So that's one of the things, and I find it interesting. You get into that kind of Android world of there's this tablet chipset, and this one can't run on Intel chipset Android devices. It can only run on ARM processors. So I'm interested to see. I'm hoping they made it to the biggest audience possible.
Mm-hmm. I'm not seeing anything.
The only thing that I saw today and didn't reference specific devices, it just referenced, and I don't remember which iteration of the OS it was, but you know, this OS version or higher,
mm-hmm. Okay.
should be able to use it.
Because one of the things that I have that Samsung Galaxy camera, and I really really like it because it has the 21x zoom lens on it.
Oh yeah,
and like the first couple versions of Vine worked great, and then Vine like regulated themselves to only specific types of devices, and the camera has a weird identifier that it's not a phone, it's not a tablet, it's kind of this in between. Mm-hmm. And when Vine did that, I wasn't able to do Vines on it anymore.
I'm kind of curious to see, because if you've done Periscope, you know, on here, you get your stats, and if they're on Periscope, you see them. Now at the bottom, there's been, you know, web and not, you know, people not on there. And I think, does anybody know, if you click the link on Android, maybe Wheels, you can tell me in the chat room, if you click the link on to like my tweet for a Periscope on Android, did it previously pop up as a browser and did it run? Because I'm wondering if you're going to see those numbers change down here, and maybe I'll just notice more people popping up. Like I see a lot of them right now. I have 7-8 viewers, and most of them are users. Some of them are in this room, and I'm getting periscoped over there by Katie. So I'm going to periscope her periscope. We're going to cross the streams here, and there you go. and then the other fun thing is a shout out, since he's in the Periscope, to Ken, and I want to get your username here.
Ooh, the camera.
I think
ooh,
he's
ooh,
yeah.
Ooh, ooh, wait a minute! I just flipped the camera, and Periscope has stopped.
Oh no!
Unfortunately, Periscope has stopped.
Yeah.
Maybe if you start with the camera flipped.
Let's try that. It was like nonstop.
It didn't stop entirely. It tells me that the connection is lost.
Mm.
You're still there somewhere.
I did install it to my Nexus that's sitting on my nightstand, so I can't really test it right now as we were sitting here. But hey, props to Ken Smellsgood out there. He gets web viewers. Oh, he says he gets web viewers and he doesn't share the link on Twitter. That's interesting. That's interesting too. But he's been really trolling people on Periscope. Like he's been putting titles like descriptive porn. And it's just him sitting there and talking to people. Like there's something, like I saw a bunch of those come over my Twitter, or actually the notifications on here. And finally he's like, no lesbians here, Sorg. And I said, bah, and went away. So he's kind of having a fun trolling experiment over there. If you want to check out what he's doing, and hi, Mike's on there as well. So anyways, but no, yeah, great that it's expanding. This is where the real war is going to happen between them. And I think Meerkat is still kind of in a beta sort of situation. So we'll see kind of how they fight it out as more people get in there.
I have had Periscope shut down twice on me already.
Oh, wow.
Both when I tried to flip the camera.
He says wife showering got him 250 viewers, but it was just him sitting there drinking Fireball. Like, this is the kind of stuff he's doing. So you can have a lot of fun with that and get some other users. So goodbye Periscope, and we'll get back to the regular show. And even that, we got.
You can't do.
I had 18.
You could do up. Meerkat. You could do Meerkat from a PC, but you can't do Periscope from your basic computer. Can you?
You can't broadcast either from a computer. You have to. It has to be on a mobile phone. Jagoff is live. I wonder if he had an Android. We'll see what's going on there. Anyways, but go check it out. Periscope, definitely get into it. It's the new rage. Welcome, Android people. You know, this is like when Instagram got on Android, right? And, you know, finally it opened up. Chilla, what is your... I saw this earlier today. What's your awesome thing of the week?
So my awesome thing is Microsoft today announced that they are cross-platforming Cortana, which we thought was probably coming sooner than later. So for those of you who aren't aware, Cortana, the voice assistant, it's actually based off of the voice assistant in Halo, competitor to things like that person that talks on Apple devices and OK, that other Android platform.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to set off a bunch of devices all at once. But this is I find this interesting for one mere fact that, if you remember years ago, prior to, Avengers being, was it Avengers released on DVD or Iron Man 3 released on DVD? We reviewed Jarvis, which was an app that was also artificial intelligence, but it was based on, it had some plugins to the DVD or Blu-ray when you were watching, but it also had a bunch of AI type stuff that it could service. And it did really well with a whole slew of things. Obviously, you're not going to be able to say to initiate Cortana via voice with like in a hands-free mode. And she's not going to have access to things like your hardware and turning things on and off like you can on an iPhone and saying, hey, you know who, turn off Bluetooth or turn on Bluetooth or do whatever. But I really feel like this is going to continue to push the envelope for competition. And I think it's something that I have pretty good luck a lot of times with Google's platform. But I feel like it's as an Apple device user, it definitely lacks. But I feel like Siri understands and uses a lot of general information and gets me the what I'm actually looking for a lot faster and easier, versus it's usually my second or third hit on the Google platform. And like I said, I just really think this is going to push the ball forward for everyone. And I always think competition's good, just like Periscope coming to Windows Phone. That's the one thing I think that really hurts them is they don't have the Google platform and they don't have things like Instagram. But this is just another step in Microsoft putting everything everywhere. Obviously, it's going to be the best on the Microsoft platform, but it's just another option for people to use on their device.
There's a really good talk about Microsoft in general, how when you're considering an iPad and considering what the difference is between that and like a Surface and what you get for that for usability,
mm-hmm.
it's kind of a debate now, whereas it wasn't, a couple years ago, right?
Yeah.
They really got to that point. And it's interesting to see them kind of rise up again. I think it's only a matter of time before you see iPad in trouble, unless they do something very, very interesting in the next year.
What is it? The one thing I think that, and Crazy Krause and I were talking about this, the one thing that I think is definitely going to be a big game changer for them is the touchscreen devices, tablets with styluses, and the ability to annotate websites.
Yeah.
So I could bring up a website for the show, right? And I could draw right on it. Like I was showing instant replay footage on a sporting event.
Right.
That kind of thing I think is going to be where they really push the envelope, where the iPad, you have to take a screenshot, then run into Sketch, draw your arrows, draw this, that. I mean, this is where I think Microsoft coming in late to the game always does them pretty well. Where I think they're really going to have the issue is just market penetration. I mean, look what it took for you to update your iPad, mm-hmm. because the old one was doing just fine for most things? I mean, and how far are you off from updating yet again? I don't know.
Right. It's already kind of a how soon? How much longer do I have on this iPad 3? Right. And I'll still find use of it.
I think the 3, you're still probably going to get iOS 9, so mm-hmm. you're going to be at least good for another year. And that's where I think Microsoft expects faster hardware iteration and transition for a user. And I think Apple, while they have their fan club, people get a lot more longevity out of their device.
Right. Right.
So I think that's going to be a tough thing for Microsoft to break in with market penetration numbers. But if they can go cross-platform, why does it matter? I mean, if I already have an iPad and I can load Word, Excel, Cortana, PowerPoint, whatever I need, I don't see what the big deal is.
They're turning into Google. They keep saying they're going to be a services company. So they want you in this area. They're not buying devices necessarily. The phones, yeah, they mostly are selling most of their own phones now that they bought Nokia. But aren't there still like Samsung Windows phones out there too?
And I heard they were going to do another one. There's the HTC One.
Right.
I mean,
so it's not about selling devices. It's not about even selling the Surface. It's not about anything like that. They get, of course, licenses on most of these, except for the smaller. I guess even the phones are. I think they're probably on the free zone under their new licensing, right?
Yes.
So, yeah, it's just, you know, like Android, you know, I have the Google experience on my iPhone, and it just would be best if you're on an Android for it in general, because you get all the extras features for it. So I don't know about what it's going to take for this phone to catch on, but I think in general the services are going to. So, because I mean, how many people have Windows computers still and will be upgrading? And they'll just kind of follow that along to whatever they're on.
And once you upgrade, and I'm interested to see how this plays out for you, Sorg. I heard today, once you upgrade,
yeah.
If you are not an enterprise customer, which I'm sure there's all kinds of expense and magical hoops you have to jump through to become an enterprise customer. Once you upgrade, there is no option to not update ongoing.
Well, then we are never going to update the studio computer. Holy crap. That's a problem.
Yeah, and that was an interesting thing. And I don't want to digress down a complete just epic hole of Microsoft. But that was one of the things I was listening to on Windows Weekly, was they were talking about the new SKUs and the whole update model. And one of the things Microsoft's blaming a lot of their issue on is that everybody's at a different point in the life cycle. And everyone is at different patch versions across different operating systems, across everything. And jeez. Now for the majority of the home editions and even the small business SKUs and whatnot, you're not going to have an option.
Yeah, we're just going to stick around on 8.1 on the studio machine. It seems to be chugging around just fine.
But what's interesting is, do you think they're going to stop? So 8 and 8.1 didn't get a lot of enterprise and corporate pickup. It was probably primarily only sold on new computers.
Yeah.
And obviously the Surface 1 and the Surface Pro 1 and 2 did not sell as well as the 3 is selling now. It'll be interesting to see how much longer they support 8, primarily because, don't forget, it's free upgrade. Are we gonna see a long life cycle out
right.
of?
I don't mind. I'm running Windows XP on some of these machines, and I still get the pop up about how service ended like a year ago. So I mean, when you're in a production environment, you stay on what works. I'm gonna stay on the last version of Wirecast. There's a new one since. I don't need the new features. I'm gonna stay on Windows 8.1. It works. I don't need new features. I can turn this on, hit record, stream. We're going. And anything that messes with that, any new software, I mean, that's why you go to most production houses, you know, even graphics people, you know, they don't want their Photoshop messed with, you know, and they'll stay on. Some people are hanging on to their Macs with Leopard on them that so they can run that Photoshop CS4 version that they still have a copy of because they paid $600-$700 for it, damn it. They're not letting it go anytime soon. And they're not sold on this newfangled world where you pay a subscription for $10 a month for that same software. They're just not there. How many versions, how many Mac Office 2011s are you seeing out there in the wild?
Oh, yeah.
You know, I had somebody said, here, just put Office on this new, on this Mac. And I'm like, and they actually, I think they handed me an Office Mac 2007. And I was like, yeah, wrong CPU? I can't, aside from the fact that there's no CD drive in this thing, you know, I brought mine in and no, this isn't happening. Sorry. And that's kind of it. But yeah. Yeah. Anyways. All right. I got one. Let's bring it around. On podcasting, we're actually going to be addressing this question tomorrow night. Of course, evening with PodCamp, Crystal O'Connor from Libsyn will be joining us. And I'm going to ask her specifically about the Libsyn deal with Spotify. Why is that important? Well, they announced a few things. They're redoing, they're rebranding, they're adding on to Spotify, the music service. And, you know, there's been, you know, a lot of conversation about the artists, what they're getting paid. What is that model going to work for Spotify? There's a couple things. First, this was interesting. So I kind of got a double. This isn't the thing I'm excited about, but it's part of the story. Spotify will match music to your running pace. Okay, that's interesting. You know, that could really kind of appeal to a lot of people that are out there working out. And I guess
especially if it's really, really slow.
But still, so what happens? What if I'm just not a fast runner, right? Why am I not getting anything over like mid-tempo grunge at this point, right? And I'm curious to see how that applies. Or maybe they just say, "Oh, this is you being fast. Okay, we'll speed it up," you know, for instance. But the big thing is for me, they have a lot of video content coming to it, much like I feel like we're seeing with Snapchat, like Comedy Central, part of this picture of Broad City here on this article from Engadget, for instance. But NBC, ESPN, ABC, all part of this. So that software, including Amy Poehler, is actually going to be producing exclusive content for Spotify on the service. Okay. But also via... no, there's actually something else. But they're actually also adding podcast to this. You're not going to see Awesomecast on this next week unless we change our service providers. Libsyn is one of the original partners. So if you're on Libsyn, and I presume there's some other ones there, this is the big name that I've heard connected to this, but if you're on Libsyn, you're going to have an option, and all it is checking a box. It's not any additional fee or anything like that, and you will be listed on Spotify. Which... that's a huge audience.
That is a giant audience, and I wonder if this is going to force some people to switch providers.
It's making me consider it. Yeah, I'll be quite honest. It's making me consider it, and I've stated, anytime I have a client that we have a budget or anything like that, they go on Libsyn. It's not even a question. And actually, that is I'm going to put my client podcast on Spotify. We'll look at that when I get into the office here later this week after this break here. And we'll see what that experience is like. And it's going to be really great for them, you know. But I need to move from my host that I've been on for a really, really long time.
And that's a lot of data to move.
It's a lot of data to move. Now, I understand. I think Libsyn's good about helping you with that. Like, they're pretty good with the customer service side of things. And I've heard about people moving their feeds and having to deal with the old providers. And they do that interfacing with you. It kind of feels like if you go to GoDaddy and say, hey, please take me from this server and put my WordPress over here. Like, they do that. I don't know entirely. That could be a question we can ask tomorrow, for instance. But a big, big bump for podcasting in general. Obviously, not all of us are going to feel it. It's going to be the best of the best, or at least the ones that are decided to go with Libsyn, which is probably one of, if not the most popular podcasting service out there. I understand there may be some other things similar to this cooking up that we might be talking about tomorrow night. If I read that email correctly, and I didn't just break an NDA. I didn't sign anything. But anyways, but you're seeing a lot of this kind of stuff. You're seeing, you know, it just lends to kind of the growth of podcasting or the regrowth of podcasting, whatever you want to call it. And I think it's really cool to see. It's actually made me download Spotify. I don't know what I'm going to do with it. I'm already listening to 3 different music services right now, depending on my mood. So the mood, and I don't give a crap to really decide what I'm listening to right now. So I don't know. What do you guys think? Any other thoughts of this before we move on?
I think it's one more thing that would make me think about getting a Spotify subscription.
Yeah,
I'm still on the fence of what.
Well, you don't pay for this part, but it's still like,
yeah, you don't pay for this. But I feel like I want to have an all-in-one type of bundle type of thing.
That'd be nice.
And it's one more thing to get people to the platform and then get them paying, mm-hmm. which obviously the whole point of these services is somebody has to make money.
But it also doesn't have everything. It's not like I get annoyed when something's not on Stitcher. And the only thing that keeps somebody from being on Stitcher is putting their feed in Stitcher.
Right.
Right. And that bothers me. You know, to go to, I don't know if I would go to Spotify. This is for somebody who hasn't already discovered their slew of podcasts, I think. I think this more helps. I'm already on Spotify. This keeps me there.
But see, to me, it's also a selling point.
Okay.
Because it would get me over to there, because it's one more it's one more thing where I only have to go one place.
Mm-hmm.
Like we were talking about earlier, I feel like I don't want to be. I like the Flipboard experience because it brings everything to one portal for all of my news and social media and stuff. If I just want to peruse and not comment past like a like, whereas I still can't find that from an audio perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Like I want my search when I go into the search panel and I want to search for Awesomecast or I want to search for They Might Be Giants, it should, I don't want to have to jump from service to service to service to try to piecemeal everything together, which is one of the reasons that the whole get Hulu and get Netflix and get Amazon Insta Prime and get this and get that. It's like by the time you're done, you're saving $20. I would rather just not watch anything on the USA Network.
Right.
And call it a day.
Right.
Right. I use Spotify because it makes the most sense for me and how I consume music. And as John says, if I'm already there and I'm already paid for the service, it becomes more attractive to me if it, and it doesn't have to be everything, but a good selection of podcasts, some interesting video on top of that, makes Spotify nearly untouchable, as far as a streaming entertainment option for me.
And I think one of the things for me is Spotify has an offline mode, and mm-hmm. offline for me is big because I have those breaks in my commute every day where yep. I lose connectivity. So yeah,
if you have a subway, if you have a spotty yep. connection on mm-hmm. your way out to work, it is big for people. That's why downloading podcasts to an iPod was so popular for the time being,
mm-hmm.
for instance, because we didn't all have connected. No one had connectivity back then, for one thing. So, all right. Kitty, did you have anything on this?
No, you guys covered.
Okay, just checking. Make sure I didn't skip anybody.
So soon we may be saying YouTube, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and Spotify.
Oh, God.
I don't even name most of the other ones. We're on more services.
Oh, you should name them all.
Oh, jeez.
We could make it like a sing-along.
But you're like, but you submit to these directories.
You need a jingle, is what you need.
Ooh.
There's, you submit to these directories, and even just being on, by being on iTunes, you're on, I don't know, just submit your thing to iTunes. Leave it up there for 6 months. Hopefully you're still doing a podcast in the meantime. And just go search for your podcast, and find out how many sites you ended up on. You know, I actually found one of our shows from 2 years ago, that, and then I called them up and said, hey, why is my thing, oh, not called them, I emailed them, I used a contact form, like a gentleman, and and I said, hey, I'm interested in your service, but I noticed you have some stuff for 2 years ago. Let's have a discussion. And we had a discussion, and it looks like we're going to get a show on their network, and I'm very interested in doing that. And it turned out very well. Or half the time, the site's in Japanese. That's the other thing, too. But at least it's getting out there, right? Mm-hmm. It's a place people can discover you. And that can help. As long as everything leads back and they're not scraping it and reposting it so you can see. But not that I'm too mad about that, because we do release everything Creative Commons. And even if I can't track anything, I can kind of always skew that. Well, and there's more, because there's stuff we can't track. There's just always going to be more. It's out there. It's in the internet. It's in the wild. Archive.org. I'm putting stuff on there now, too. Just so it's there. So I know that this conversation is in the Library of Congress, and that's cool by me. anyways. So let's talk about connectivity with pizza. Okay? Slice on Broadway, friends of ours, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with great pizza. And oh, where it there comes. Pizza, they help us out. They feed our in-studio guests here. Whoa. And we pizza the mics here.
Pizza everywhere.
Rico and the crew doing some good stuff. And it's fresh. Okay, it's not that. It's been sitting down here for like 2 hours, but still.
Still tastes good.
Still amazing. Fresh ingredients. And they have fun. Kitty had a Hello Kitty pizza a few weeks ago for her birthday, for instance.
You know, we pull the pizza box out and Wicket shows up.
Oh, yeah. The dog likes it. but go check them out there on the main street in the main drag here in Beachview along the tracks. Main Street down in Carnegie, PA, if you can find an exit to get down there. I understand it's a little crazy on the parkway right now. But if you can, please go check them out. And they've been supporting us for well over a year. And they've hosted us a couple of times for their Awesomecast last year. I think we did our anniversary show there. And maybe we'll do it on such short notice because we just realized it's next week, for instance. But go check them out, sliceonbroadway.com, PGH_slice on the Twitters, and of course, look them on Facebook and Instagram. So let's get back to the non-pizza related news. I don't know. You never know. We could be doing drone delivery again. But getting into it. Hey, Instagram, they're doing highlight emails coming to your inbox. One, hey, you got more bacon coming to your inbox, guys. Yay! Because you already turned off all those Facebook and LinkedIn and YouTube notifications, right? You know, for me, actually, I welcome something like this because I like that one focal point. Like, this is what keeps me still with Google Plus, is I get to review my emails, and they're grouped in inbox already. So I was like, hey, here's all my stuff from Google Plus, here's all my stuff from LinkedIn, and we can say, good, okay, move on, and whatnot. Pinterest, it's really nice for Pinterest, for me to remember that I have a Pinterest account, and post a couple things every once in a while. It gets me back in there. What do you guys think of this? Anybody Instagramming?
We're already on
I do, and I'm not sure. Totally how, to be honest, I'm not sure how much I pay attention to this. I have stuff sort of organized. Mm-hmm. When these start showing up, I have it open all the time anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure that this is a huge thing for
some
me.
Some people maybe have a lot of people they follow, and it just kind of gets buried in there, and you just need to surface it. Or
yeah,
maybe I'm good busy and I haven't gone to my Instagram, says, hello, I'm here. You go back to your Instagram.
I totally agree. As a person that was on Instagram from like a long, long time before there was any other integration, and I just had a Gmail account with my Instagram account. In fact, I don't have it. My Instagram is not linked to anything, which I'm sure people find weird.
That is weird. That is very strange.
I mean, it's totally linked. Like, totally it'll show up on Facebook, but when I log into Instagram, I log in with my email account and my Instagram password, not with any other like cross auth.
No, they don't do that. There's no cross auth.
I thought you could cross auth with Facebook.
Not that I'm aware of. I don't know. I'm signing out and in like every time, so maybe I'm doing this wrong.
But so anyway, I was on very early, and now I do wish, I could add groups like you can on Twitter, so I could quickly go in and resurface people.
That would be cool.
That's where I find this feature is going to be very nice, as long as they do a decent job of surfacing what I want them to surface. Does it say in here how they're determining Is it based on, because if it's just based on likes or something like that, I don't know if it's going to be enough for me. To my point earlier, I wish there was a way for me to group people or to group things.
Well, didn't Twitter at one point, I turned off a lot of my Twitter notifications, but at one point would send you, this is email saying, this is what you missed from blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, and there's a what mm-hmm. you missed when you've gone back to the app.
Yeah, but it used to be an email specifically, but I remember turning it off.
Yeah, and there's an email that's like, based on you following this person, follow these people, and based on something you put in a hashtag, here's other content. It was more surfacing things that you may not be aware of because you don't follow.
Okay.
But to me, this is surfacing people that you do follow. But again, like I said, how are they determining what they surface? Because if it's just based on likes or something like that, there's some people I follow that I know that have a ton of followers that are just going to be plenty of likes, and I'm not going to get the stuff I want surfaced.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's where, like, there's Flow for the iPad, I think. And there's also an Grids for Instagram for macOS that I really like for this reason, because I can bring up an entire pages and pages all at once.
Yeah.
Of Instagram photos and play go with through those. Them.
Also, really nice if you do have multiple accounts to get into them and be interactive with them without having to juggle, you know, logging in and out of several of them. And then my biggest issue with Instagram is I don't connect any other social media to my accounts except for my personal one, because I always seem to screw that up and I post a picture to the wrong Facebook or Twitter, depending on how my phone's set up. And that gets a little embarrassing sometimes, you know, when you're dealing with clients and such. Yeah, it's almost the point, because of something like Instagram, you need the client phone to do the social media for the client, and you just cannot interact it with your own at a certain point, especially if you're prolific on social media to begin with. So, all right, let's take a look at a couple things here. Chilo, which of your stories you want to bring up here?
So, back on the Microsoft beat, Microsoft has made, and I'm interested to see how this plays out. Microsoft has made a deal with, I think, LG and Sony that their apps are going to come preloaded on Android tablets. So if you pick up one of the tablets, and I'm sure this is going to bleed over to phones as well.
Yeah.
But here's the catch 22, right? And I noticed this on my Samsung. So I have the Samsung Galaxy S6. It came preloaded with Office, but the device came direct from Samsung. If I go into the AT&T store, it doesn't come preloaded with the same stuff, because AT&T altered the image that's distributed in their stores. It doesn't take anything away when I got the OS update or anything, but I'm interested to see. I'm glad they're going with tablets first, because I don't see many people that get a 3G, 4G LTE tablet. They're usually picking up their Android tablets and wherever they get their electronics. But what is this going to do for Docs, Sheets, and whatever Google's...
Doesn't this... but you're not getting it for free. You still have to pay for the service, right?
You still have to pay for the service, but it's the you can do the viewers, and I've heard more and more some of the suite, the basic capabilities might be available.
You're seeing this a lot. Of course, you know, we've been hearing about Microsoft making deals with that alternative Android
Cyanogen.
Yes, and basically doing a Microsoft up version of this, and Microsoft really kind of stepping in on a lot of Android versions like this. I think this is the solution. I think you're going to get a Microsoftified Android phone, and that's going to be the thing that actually does take off versus a Windows phone. People are familiar with Android, and get a Microsoft version of that is going to... I think there's going to be a comfort zone with people, you know? Or maybe even if you are ingrained as a BYOD Office person, and you're like, I got to have my Outlook, having the device that says Microsoft all over it is... you're going to find more of them, I think, at a certain point here. Or having that on there on the Samsung LG, like, oh, I can do my office here. That is an attractive point to people that use that,
mm-hmm.
that depend on those software programs.
Especially if you've tried to use, like, other third-party viewers for PowerPoint documents.
Yeah, and you realize how much doesn't work.
pie charts, and, like, it's like 50%, and the pie chart is just either 100% full, or it looks like Wingdings font everywhere. Mm-hmm.
It's hard enough going, and somebody's not worked because, you know, again, the office situation, somebody went to a pretty big, the keynote for this conference had videos, and there were no videos. And I'm wondering, you know, was it a thing that they weren't embedded, or was it a version problem? Mm-hmm. You know, they were on a Mac. That's definitely an older version of Office on that Mac. What didn't work?
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, I think you're always going to have that. I see problems making stuff in Keynote and throwing it up to Google Slides.
Mm-hmm.
It's an issue.
So keeping it, allowing that to cross-platform, especially from at least the viewer perspective, I think it's going to give them inroads. And I wonder, like I said, I really like to see the competition. I'm hoping this doesn't hurt the competition and other companies don't continue to update their products or try to really push the envelope. Maybe we'll see something at Google I/O next week, and Google's going to come back with some kind of power play. But I don't know. I'm very interested to see how this plays out, and will it bring people back to a lot of the Microsoft platforms that wouldn't typically use them on their phone
mm-hmm.
or mobile device.
So I came across this app, and the link I have there, if you guys are in the show notes, it's actually an email I got. It says, "We miss you at Moju." And I'm like, well, I didn't know that I missed Moju. And I don't know. Maybe I got on a list. Maybe this used to be another app that I tried out and I downloaded it once. Did I cover this?
I think so, in an old show.
We did. So they did miss me at Moju.
You just didn't miss them.
I didn't miss them. Maybe I signed up for it. Okay.
A really, really good impression.
Maybe it's worth revisiting a little bit. So I downloaded the app and I was like, okay, let's check it out. Their email marketing worked. Okay. Moju, if you want to check this out. Now, what happens is, if you go to some of the samples here on their website, let me pop that up. Also, they caught my attention because there's a May Apple Watch giveaway. So if you go make some Mojus, you're automatically entered. So this was my experience first popping into this. So you make these. It looks like Instagram. It looks so much like Instagram. It's ridiculous, right? Look at that font. Look at that blue bar across the top. But what happens is if you're on the web, I'm moving my mouse left to right, and you see an animation happen, right? Now, I haven't made one of these yet. But, and also, you guys are familiar with Facebook when they do images, and there is a paper, it was that application they did, and there's that, you know, you move your phone and it moves from side to side,
mm-hmm.
and that is happening here with this glass of iced tea and the light over it. You know, it's catching that accelerometer, and it's adding movement to it. Now, I'm kind of curious, how do I make one? I haven't looked at that yet. But, I mean, again, it's one of those, like, it's a cool idea.
Well, I think that we were talking about, when we talked about this, we were talking about, like, 3D, because you can definitely give, like, a 3D effect to things.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Like, you could 3D almost scan, like, a action figure or something along those lines. And I think we were talking about this back when Vine first started. Like that's where I want to think that we kind of started the conversation. But it's an interesting concept. The one thing I will say that does not lend itself well is the web interface. Right. Having to drag your cursor across the picture left to right does not work as well as using the accelerometer, to your point, on the phone.
You can actually do it. I did it one real quick here in the studio that should be posting to my Facebook, I think. It's actually uploading right now. It is just you move your phone in a motion, and that's it. And you guys can see here in the studio what's going on. I want to see if I can get the Facebook on there as well.
Your Facebook came up.
Oh, my Facebook came up? Oh, Facebook error. Oh, wasn't able to share to Facebook. That's interesting. Cool. But, you know, you just get that little bit of a movement. And, you know, and this is just moving my phone back and forth. So it's like a motion Instagram, and I'm still kind of figuring out, why would I do this? I don't know what the audience is there. I feel like this is something, I think this would be interesting if it integrated into Instagram. Like, if this was a feature of Instagram, I think like people would take advantage of that more than say video, for instance. So worth looking at. Check it out, Moju Labs.
But I find it completely addicting, though.
Yeah.
Like,
and that's the hook.
Like, I could sit here, like, this is bad. Like, I could sit here for quite some time and just, aw, look at the kitty. But, like, no, I mean, like, I go to their website and check them out, because, like, you just sit here and I feel like, and I don't want to stop hitting load more.
And this one, this has a lot of stuff, and they're putting multiple images in here, and you have to really move your mouse slow in order to go look through this labyrinth, Stonehenge-y looking thing. You know, I mean, it's, you can do a lot with it, and maybe you can do something and kind of, you can make like 80s music video looking stuff out of this.
There's no audio, though.
There's no audio. It's all visuals. Here's one that's like definitely a bunch of different pictures, and you can see the vertical horizontal pictures go kind of crazy. You know, so it doesn't really work out all that great. Or here's one where you create a little bit of an animation coming around. You know, just, you know, this is just them kind of plugging their hashtag campaign here. It's interesting. It is interesting. It's not video. And I'm also curious to see how does this play out on Facebook as well. So maybe that's something that we'll be playing with over the next week. So
speaking of Instagram and a little bit of a video here, sorry, I'm totally jumping off track here. Dunkin Donuts. I follow Dunkin Donuts on Instagram. They did a video, and it's a very short loop of like 2 seconds of this. I don't know if you can see it there, but it's the water moves. So it looks like a picture. And then the water's just moving.
Okay, is that sponsored?
No, I actually follow Dunkin' Donuts.
Okay.
But it's these two girls sitting by the pool with their drinks, and it's a very, like I said, it's a looping tube or something video. So it looks like the girls aren't moving. Nothing in the scene is moving except for the water. So you're just kind of like this really chill looking. And I've never seen anyone use video like that before.
Really subtle, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it catches your attention. Is there anything else in there? Is there any logos or anything?
The only thing is their drinks.
And now think, they made that video, they put it on Instagram, that automatically went to Facebook most likely, and now that is also auto-playing in your Facebook feed. So, and again, something that you can slide by, and it catches you. Wait, was that moving? Wait, was that video? Wait, what was this? And now you're looking at the Dunkin' Donuts account in general. And here, I'm going to pull it up here so you guys can see it.
Look at certain parts of the water, you can see where it kind of...
Oh, yeah. You can definitely see the water moving in this video.
But you can see the loop. It's just really neat because it looks like it's just...
I am kind of curious because I feel like they cut everything else out. And I feel like this is a picture in the front. Like, because there's no look of movement. Like, it actually, as I'm looking at this, I think I can kind of tell the cutouts, too.
Watch the water right between the drinks, and it's a loop.
Yeah.
And it's, so if these girls are just sitting there and not moving, I mean, like, I'm not, you know what I mean? It really could go either way.
Now we're deciphering this thing, and meanwhile,
Dunkin' Donuts has kept you past your 32-second threshold of attention.
Even more so. Yeah. And we've exposed their logo to our entire audience for how long right now?
Yeah.
And
now I'm one of those orange slushies.
Yeah. Way to go, Dunkin' Donuts.
Somebody needs to make a Dunkin' Donuts run. Anyways, please sponsor us.
We love you.
I'll eat poorly if it's all sponsored easily. That diets be damned if they sponsor us. Anyways. Send us munchkins. Too bad Timmy
hosts. Boston cream.
Boston cream. Oh, jeez. Mm-hmm. Oh, jeez. Chilla, it is time for you, because I think you're the one who follows everything as close as anything. I hear the rumors. But it's time for you to speculate wildly, as a podcast will do, on Google I.O. coming up this week.
When you all thought I was crazy with the new MacBook getting one USB-C port.
I still think you're crazy, and Apple is included on that.
And I was just kind of reiterating. So Google I.O. ended end of this week, the 28th.
Thursday is the keynote, and that's going to be very difficult for me to go to listen to.
I do think we're obviously going to get a new Android flavor or candy.
Was it M?
M.
M&M's?
I don't think they're going to go for another partnership like that. I think it's going to... If they do, I hope it's Mallow Cup.
I feel like...
I'm a huge fan. Mallow Cup. I know. I'm old. Mallow Cup. Saying that Mallow Cup's rock.
I think that's going to be very divisive.
Maybe this is where Mellow Yellow makes their move.
Ooh.
But anyway, so we'll get a flavor or a new candy snack operating system. And we didn't get the name the last time, if you remember. It was Android L for a very long time.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we'll get the name, but I think we're going to hear a lot about Wear. I think you're going to see it go cross-platform. Mm-hmm. I think they're going to follow Microsoft on the cross-platform journey.
Ooh, I got some watch talk after this, by the way. I want to fit in real quick.
Okay. You laughed at me also for Aura, which is the modular phone that they've kind of kicked off in full-fledged Puerto Rico. I think that's going to take center stage. I think they're going to attempt yet again at more TV type stuff. If you remember the review from many, many moons ago and the queue that never made its shelves. And then we're now on the Google TV with the Nexus Puck. I think we may see some stuff on Auto as it hit Hyundai this week. They kind of made some announcements. I think you're going to see some stuff in VR that takes Cardboard to the next level. And there was one other thing that I read about that was seemed like it could definitely be a play. I think if they really want to sweep it, I think you're going to see or at least hear about Google Glass V2.
Really?
I think if I know Google, they know that the HoloLens took center stage. I think you're going to start, and they've started to redo what they're doing with Google Glass. I think we're going to see, or at least hear about, the extension of maybe Wear come to the next version of Glass. Because there's no reason why it couldn't.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is they're starting in the new version of Wear to take into account the accelerometer to be able to do things beyond just the touch. And if you pay attention as a Google Glass owner and an Android Wear owner, a lot of the finger gestures on Wear are the finger gestures on, not that there's that many on either, but are the same finger gestures on Glass. So I think the Wear operating system based on Lollipop is going to be easily portable to the Glass. And they're getting full day battery life out of Wear, and putting that into and adding a camera on should not be hard to put on your head. So we can talk next week on how many things I was wrong on and how awesome I am.
Oh, we'll be going. I'll probably have a quick mini Awesomecast probably sometime Thursday with some quick comments and kind of a rundown of it. I think that's how we're going to use that this week at least. We'll see how
someone said like day two there was a big keynote.
I thought they were only having one this year.
Where did I read? So just about Google's advanced technology and products division does make headlines, and the outfits gets a primo slot on IO day two.
Huh.
To spell its secrets.
Well, you mentioned watches, and I did get a chance this past week to try out the Apple Watch.
So I'm still sitting here waiting for mine to even move past ordering process or order processing. So what were your thoughts? Because I never even tried one on.
Well, there it is. I did put on my Pebble watch right next to it. Missy went in. She's actually really considering it. I like it. It's really slick. And actually, I can't see any more. The black aluminum on Sport Edition, I like.
That's what I got.
That's all I would get. That's seriously all I would get. And I like, you know, and again, I have the comparison photo here. I completely see getting it, and I still have the Pebble as like the, I don't want this to get messed up today watch, right?
How did the back, and this is something I'm realizing, and I actually took it off because Christopher goes crazy when it's on my wrist when I get home from work. So I have actually gotten in the habit of taking it off when I get home.
Mm-hmm.
But the Moto 360, it's not comfortable on my wrist.
Really?
And that's the one thing. I've gotten more and more, I will say I've gotten more and more used to it.
Mm-hmm.
But I've also gotten more and more used to not being able to use the heartbeat sensor and not to be able to use some of the back end setup because I cannot handle it being that tight to my wrist all day long.
Because you need it tight like that. Mm-hmm. I've actually been wearing this super like on the widest loop and just letting it kind of hang. And I've also had a little bit of a skin irritation because of some poison oak stuff I'm still trying to clear up here. And I keep re-irritating it with the watch. But it was comfortable. Okay. And you know, again, you know, just you get 15 minutes with the thing, even if that. But the process was interesting. And I was glad I waited because I wasn't like didn't have to get a schedule a time or anything like that. I could tell. I swear, nice older lady showing us this and talking like I like this. It's fashionable and da da da. You know, kind of giving that kind of advice to it, mm-hmm. which I'm just like, what? Where am I? You know, I was very. It had a great conversation. We talked for a good 20 minutes, or so about it. Both Missy and I tried them on, and I'm like this. They hired that lady. She was showing off jewelry in Macy's before this. Had to have been, right? Like, you can tell that's the people they're hiring for something like this.
If you're coming into the store, you know what this does.
Exactly.
So you're that might be the push is like, oh, you know what? This is kind of funny, you know, but oh, man, on your wrist, it looks great.
Exactly. And then she has the drawer that comes out, the secret drawer comes out, ooh. And you get all these different bands. And she talked to me into trying out the medium model of it because get the nicer band. It's a silver. But I seriously do just like the black aluminum better, just as far as a look for me. You know, I'm very basic when it comes to those kinds of things. And With the fluoroelastic, which even she says, that's a fancy name for rubber.
I like her.
She was great. She was tremendous.
Did you try on any of the other bands, though?
I did. I just tried it on, like, the sport one and then, like, the... Oh, which one was it? I didn't do the metal one. But what was the other one? I think it might have been leather. Not leather. Do they have leather? Something like that. Whatever that fancy named one was, that's the Milanese loop. And a Milanese loop.
What was
loop.
The clasp like on that? Because isn't it like kind of like a magnet?
Yes, it was, and I kept playing with it. I kept like I'm just playing with the magnet on my wrist. Just keep talking.
So back to our conversation about the band and being tight to the wrist.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that is actually one of the things that they really took time on was the clasp and the ability to clasp at any point. If you're not using the fluoroelastomer, AKA rubber, band. And that's where I feel like they really thought through the concept of, I have to have something flat laying against my wrist. Mm-hmm. I feel like it's going to make the comfort difference, which I didn't buy an extra band, but I think
that's
going to push me to get a different band.
Don't worry
band.
About it. You'll be fine. You'll be fine on this thing. It's
as long as it's and that, like I said, that's the one thing that I'm not happy with the Moto 360 about. And I've actually thought about, I wonder if other people are going to start making bands like they make the Apple Watch, and I would actually go out and buy a third party band for the Moto.
That was my question. I said, were they going to patent the connectors?
I don't think they're... I don't know if they're patented, but I know they're doing like a MFI standard, so you're going to be able to...
Yeah.
Other companies are going to be able to make more bands.
That's what I'm looking forward to. Like, I'm going to go to Five Below in 6 months to pick up just like I do my iPhone cases, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what's really going to happen. Let's be honest about this. All right. So with that, lots of things going around. Of course, Google I.O. Evening with PodCamp, PodCampPittsburgh.com. That's happening down at the hardware store in Allentown. We have a few other events, including, hey, Thursday, there's a P. Dutters sent me something. Katie,
a P. Dutters.
Do you know anything about P. this
Dutters.
Event?
There's a P. Dutters.
He's a Papa Dutters now.
He's a Papa Dutters.
The visualizations, I believe?
Yes, something about visualizations. Shades of Gray, Seeing Beyond the Color Encoding Data Visualization Group here in Pittsburgh. So please go check that out. Look that up on meetup.com. And we've been sending the link out on our social media as well, so you can look through on that. Great Festival is June 10th through 12th. WordCamp Columbus, July 17th through 19th. And I heard rumbling somebody's going to try to do one in Pittsburgh. So I'm looking forward to that. PodCamp Pittsburgh, of course, in August. PodCampPittsburgh.com for info there. I have a Basics of YouTube screencast thing that I did today at the Carnegie Library. You can go check that out in the outline and notes and links and all kinds of fun stuff in there if you want to get a little more in-depth with YouTube itself. We visited the Coin-Op Hall of Fame in Aliquippa and up here in Hopewell Township. We talked to Chris Aiken from there, one of the co-founders, last week on the Awesome Chat. You can check out at awesomecast.net. But we also went there for their VIP party, and you can check out the video, check out these awesome games. There's like 400 or 500 games in this place. And it's not just video games, tons of pinball, rows of pinball, and just like old stuff that I've never even seen before. I played a $6 million man pinball machine. Like obscure stuff, and it's really, really cool to see. We got a video about that, and you can check out some of the stuff we've been playing, including how goofy it looked when Chachi and I played a two-man fire truck game. They have a fire...
Did it squirt water?
No, actually, they have a fire rest... No, this one was just a driving game, and somebody just one controlled the caboose as you're rounding corners, and it's like...
Oh, God, I remember that.
You remember that?
Holy shit. Yeah, I do.
Crappy, we got to get you up to this because it stops. Wow. Like, Mortal Kombat is the newest game, and you don't have much from the 90s in this thing, right?
That's when Mortal Kombat, all you had was, like, high kick, low kick, punch, low kick.
Right. Exactly. and it has, like, RoboCop and Ghostbusters. There's no Ninja Turtles, any of those 90s classics or anything like that. It's basically through the 80s and then stops. And then they have some newer...
Tubin?
Pinball. I did not see Tubin. Ooh. There is a Paperboy. We can talk about that. We're going to talk about this extensively probably on Boss Battle right after this. So check out insertcointobegin.com about this. I just saw the video pop up over here in the corner. There's a baby, you saw for a second, a baby Pac-Man that you have the video game, and then underneath is a partial pinball machine that you just go into the tunnel and then you play pinball. And a turkey shoot game where the feathers fly when you shoot the turkeys. So... a lot of fun. Go check it out. CoinOpHOF.com to check out what they have going on there if you're in the Pittsburgh area. This video at InsertCoinToBegin.com. Anything else? Is that it? And everything?
Thank you.
Did we hit all the things?
Enough of the things.
Uncle Crappy.
Most of the things.
Check them out. UncleCrappy.com. You writing a lot over there these days? I don't know if I saw much popping up lately.
Uncle Crappy, yeah, occasionally. Occasionally. This spring has been busier than it's been for a year or two, maybe.
Well, you're helping to build a media empire over there, so.
Yes. Yes. We're working on it.
We're working on it. Slowly but surely. Hey, empire building is hard. Okay.
It's difficult work, time consuming. Mm-hmm. Got to be patient.
Exactly.
But it's coming.
His last post over here is Dynamite.
Oh, man, those are good sandwiches. Go read that one.
Oh,
go read that one. If you like Sloppy Joe's, trust me.
I haven't had Sloppy Joe in 10 years. Anyways, on the couch, K Dutters, at K Dutters on the Twitters.
Hi. I have nothing.
Hi. Hello. At Chilla on the Twitters.
That's where I can be found. Launch Chilla on the Facebooks. Awesome. How do people get old? Do they pluralize everything?
I don't know.
Something to think about.
Yes. Well, it's also the Walmarts, the Kmarts.
My mom used to always say Nintendos.
Yeah.
Well, you can check out all the awesome casts at awesomecast.net. Join us live at awesomecast.net every Tuesday, somewhere between 6 and 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Join us on the social medias, Facebook.
He's the Sorgs.
YouTube, Twitter, subscribe on YouTube, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, something or other. I don't know where all we're at these days. You can find us if you can find the Awesome Cast. If you'd listen to us, subscribe to us on the thing that you discovered us on, if you're really digging this show. You know, the thing with the buttons and the...
And the retweets and the favorites.
And the retweets and the favorites and the likes and, you know, and...
The pluses.
The pins plus and the ones. Boards and the pluses, plus ones. I don't know. Thank you to our awesome chat room that's been hopping with us all night, giving some feedback. You have been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.